over that period of time.
Okay, so now, just to kind of work backwards on this a little bit, work it from another angle, if you will. So what dollar amount do we want to receive on a monthly basis in retirement? If you had to give me a dollar amount on a monthly basis that you think would be reasonable to receive each and every month as your retirement? $3,000 to $7,000, so running off to $5,000, okay, in the middle, somewhere in the middle. So we take $5,000 a month. No, I'm asking. Okay, $5,000 a month, basically times 12, would be $60,000 a year. Okay? All right, so using what we've just sort of showed you, working at the opposite direction, the income that we would be generating would be $60,000 a year. And if we invested that while we're retired as a perpetuity at 4%, so 60,000 divided by 4% would mean we would need to accumulate $1,500,000 in our retirement savings account by the time we retired, okay? Which is pretty much the dollar amount that I think I threw out at you of saying, you know, you probably need somewhere between $1 million, $1.5 million, somewhere around there to potentially get any sort of retirement that's worth anything, okay? All right, so $1.5 million. Now, we work backwards from there, and if that $1.5 million was our future value, and we had been earning 5% interest over the 35 years, what we're really now trying to do is say, well, how much would we have to have put in on a monthly basis in order to achieve that while we were actually working? Okay, does everybody follow the logic? And this is, once again, this is going to be 12 payments per year. So basically, we need to be setting aside about $1,320 a month in our retirement scheme for it to be fully funded by the time that obviously we reach retirement age. Does that make sense? Now, this is the interesting thing. Several years ago, the standard normal sort of accumulation percentage for a lot of retirees, especially the baby boomers, was a heck of a lot higher than 5%. It was more like 10 to 15% was not uncommon for them, you know, to be, so they could put in a heck of a lot less. With you guys, unfortunately, interest rates are so ridiculously low for the investment alternatives that you have that you've got to put in a lot more in order to be able to fully fund, you know, your retirement. Okay, so this is just something to, you know, food for thought in terms of, because, you know, this logic translates whether it's raw money or you're talking about real estate. Okay, the concepts are exactly the same in terms of the financial computations. Because, you know, another way to, you know, potentially, you know, sort of look at this is, you know, we could be, you know, sort of contributing to a mortgage for that period of time that ultimately the value of the asset at the end of 35 years is worth $1.5 million, and then use that to live off of the income that it generates. Be another way to flip it. Okay? Make sense? All right. Okay. So, let's see. All right, so let's take and take a look at some annuities. Okay, and annuities are simply payments for a fixed period of time. Okay? In real estate, the most common annuity is a lease term. Okay? And by that, whenever you obviously do a residential lease, you may sign for a year. Okay? Well, you are providing an annuity for a year to your landlord while you have that lease in place. Okay? If you have a commercial tenant or you're leasing commercial space, you may have a lease for 3 years, 5 years, 10 years, 15, 20, or longer in some cases, depending on the type of tenant, depending on the amount of maybe finish out that's having to be provided by the property owner, depending on a whole number of things. And so as a result, all of that is potentially going to impact the dollar amount that you're gonna be paying up front, but also the annuity payment that they're gonna be receiving for whatever that lease term is, okay? So all an annuity is, it's just another word or term to talk about payments for a fixed period of time. So let's just say as follows. Let's say that we've got a commercial property ten-year lease, at $10,000 a month, and a discount rate of 5%. What is the present value of that lease? Okay. Now, why might this be relevant? Well, the value to a certain extent of a commercial building is the summation of all the leases that are in place within that building over the lifespan of that building. But more specifically, a lender may determine the amount that they are willing to give you as the property owner for finish out expenses for that property based upon what the present value of the lease is. They're obviously not going to want to give you more money for finish out than the value of the lease. And they're probably going to have some sort of a benchmark of saying, yeah, we're willing to give you 10% or 20% of the present value of the lease for maybe finish out. I mean, Dustin, you probably maybe have a better estimation of what that might be, but you know, every situation is a little bit different, because obviously for restaurant tenants, you're probably going to do a lot more finish out than you would maybe for a very simple, basic retail store, okay? Or, you know, it's gonna be very different than what you might do for a law firm versus, you know, a nonprofit, okay, in terms of occupying office space. So, you know, all of that is going to be different. But what we're trying to look at, though, is what is the present value of the lease, okay? So in this case, this is gonna be monthly. $10,000, in this case, this is gonna be, well, we're gonna be receiving this, so let's just go ahead and make that positive. That's gonna be a payment that we're gonna be receiving, and the interest rate or the discount rate is 5%, and this is for 10 years or 120 months, and we're looking for the present value. Okay, so what you guys got? 942. No. Oh, can we double check? double check. I'm gonna hold on.
Yeah, I got the same thing.
Yep, 942, 813, 50. Okay? So that's just simply saying to us that the present value of that lease is $942,813.50. Now, from that, then the lender will typically say, all right, we will, given that that's the flow rate of the lease, we realize that part of what you will be using that lease payment for is to obviously pay down the loan that you've taken out against the building, but we're gonna allow a certain percentage of it to be used for finish out, and so we will include that as a separate dollar amount that we will allow you to effectively use for the property in terms of getting a tenant ready. Okay, now, so we're going to get to this, talk about it a little bit. So let's talk about internal rate of return. Here what you're going to be doing is you're going to be looking at the cash flows that a property is throwing off and wanting to calculate what is going to be your annualized rate of return or internal rate of return off of this particular asset. So here's how we're going to set this up. We're going to say that we've got this property. At time period zero, and we're going to own it for 5 years, and at the end of 5 years, we're going to sell it, okay? But during that five-year holding period, we're going to have income. So in this case, we're going to keep it relatively simple. We're going to buy it for $1 million. That's going to be a negative. And then each year, it's going to throw off a different cash flow. So maybe in the first year, that's going to throw off a net cash flow of $125,000. The next year, $150,000. The next year, $100,000. The next year, $130,000. And then the final year, $140,000. Okay, so once again, from year to year, it varies significantly due to, you know, a wide variety of factors. Could be, once again, like I mentioned earlier, could be like a percentage rent for like a retailer. And so maybe from 1 year to the next, they have a different level of sales, and therefore the total income that you receive off the property is going to vary from 1 year to the next. Now, at the end of all of this, you're gonna get a reversion value or a sale price off of this asset. And we're just gonna say that it's going to be $1.2 million. I'm just pulling that number out of the air, all right? So, to put it in very simple terms, we're buying the property for $1 million, we're selling it 5 years later for $1.2 million, we're generating basically $200,000 capital gain, roughly, okay? But then, in the middle of all of that, we're getting these annual cash flows from the property, our before-tax cash flow from the property of these dollar amounts, or our net operating income, depending on which one we're using for whatever reason. But those are our incomes. So what we're going to do is we want to solve for what is the actual rate of return that we're receiving off of this. Well, if you just kind of eyeball this just for a second, you don't really even do any calculations, I mean, other than just kind of what you sort of taking $125,000, dividing that into $1 million, what sort of a rate of return is that? 12.5% for that first year. The second year, it'd be 15%. Next year, it would be 10%. Next year, 13%. Next year, 14%. And we're getting something like a 20% capital gain. Okay? Now, so that gives us kind of, at the lowest point, in any of this was 10%. At the highest point within our capital gain was 20%. So we probably should be somewhere close to that. Okay? All right, so let's just see. So what you're going to do is as follows, to put this into the calculator. First of all, it's going to be settled one payment per year, since these are annual cash flows. Okay? And you're going to put in, and once again, we'll just go ahead and kind of clear everything out, just to make sure there's nothing residual. All right? You're going to put in the $1 million plus minus, and this is where you're going to use that cash flow key, cash flow sub J. Okay, that's going to be your initial cash outflow at time period zero. Then you're going to just put in the following cash flows, $125,000 as a positive cash inflow, and then all the subsequent cash flows, $150,000, $100,000, $130,000, and then I want you to stop right there. Okay, so down to year four, you're just putting them in as they are. Okay, for the fifth and final year, since you have two different dollar amounts being received here, you've got to add them together. Okay, because the idea is you are receiving the $140,000 of the cash flow from operations on the property simultaneously with selling the property December the 31st of that year for $1.2 million. Does that make sense? So that means your final fifth year cash flow is going to be what? So $1 million, and then it's going to be, let's make sure, 140 plus 200. Yeah, 340. $1,340,000 as our final cash flow, and then all you're going to do is you're going to hit the shift key. And now be careful before you do this, let me show you what I'm talking about. You're going to hit the internal rate of return key. Okay, now look at your calculator, second row, third column under the CST button. Okay, let me pull it up here on the screen just for a second. This key right here, under the CST, it's internal rate of return for the year. Okay, that's what we're gonna be punching in. Okay, so let's do all of that. Let's see what we end up with. I get 15.8%. Okay. Now, once again, you know, if you go back and you try to be, you know, sort of intuitive about this, you know, what did we say? We said 12.5, 15, 10, 13, 14, and then 20. So by the time you, you know, you're not averaging them, but that's kind of what's happening. That you end up with the 15.8, okay? Does that make sense, conceptually? Okay, so that's all that's really telling us is, well, what is the rate of return that we are getting from the combined operating cash flow plus the resale? Now, one of the things that we're gonna be doing in here in a future class period is we're gonna be doing what's called partitioning the IRR. And what that means is we're going to basically say how much of this return, this 15.8%, is coming from the operating cash flows versus how much is coming from the reversion, okay? Because that matters. In other words, think about it like this. Different properties, because of their situation, maybe just cash cows. they may be, like, for example, perfect case in point. One of the types of properties that I love personally to invest in and have pretty much stuck with, I love the Class C, absolute bottom of the barrel quality type of properties to invest in. Why? Because there's a low cost basis relative to the rental income that you receive off of. Now the downside is you got to be very careful about your tenants. Okay? As long as you have tenants paying the rent, they're great income producing properties. Okay? But if you get the wrong tenants and they stop paying the rent, or, you know, pay late all the time or whatever, then you have problems. You know, that's what the difference is between, let's say, a Class C versus a Class A. A Class A property, you pay a lot of money up front relative to the income stream that you receive, but that income stream that you receive is stable, is constant, but you're not going to get as high of a rate of return off of that Class A property as a general rule that you're going to get off that Class C property. But it's risk adjusted, theoretically. Okay? I would argue, and if you're good at doing what you do, that Class C property will outperform that Class A property all day long. Okay? I mean, let's put it this way. How many people do you know that have owned trailer parks to go broke?
Never.
Never. How many people have you known, you know, to own pretty much just the rattiest, filthiest projects imaginable to go broke? They don't. I'm not saying that I'm going to see them to that level, but the point being is, but those are the kind of properties that people have to have a place to live. People have to, you know, ultimately have, you know, cheap places to potentially go shop, you know. And so, you know, those kind of properties, to a large extent, get ignored completely by institutional investors and large-scale players because they don't want to have to deal with a lot of the other problems that surround those kind of properties. Does that make sense? The Class A properties, yeah, those are the Starbucks, those are the ones, you know, the high-end tenants and the law firms and that sort of thing. Those are the ones that everyone is chasing. And the reason they're all chasing them is because, once again, they know that they're going to get their money every month. And they're not going to necessarily chase it down. Does that make sense? Okay, so my point with this is that in some cases, or in a lot of cases, with Class C properties, you have a very high, disproportionately high amount of your rate of return that is being generated by the operating cash flow, but whenever you try to go sell the property, you have a really difficult time trying to extract the full value of those cash flows from a prospective purchaser, because that purchaser is constantly throwing up red flags of like, oh my God, these are horrible tenants. You know, none of them are you know, potentially credit worthy. You know, but even though you're saying they pay their rent every month, you follow what I'm getting at? But then on the flip side, you have a Class A property that may not be generating, in relative terms, that much income relative to the actual sale price of the asset. Does that make sense? Because the income is considered to be more certain. Thoughts, questions, observations on that?
As far as the Class C stuff, I mean, you can make more money on it, but you have to be more knowledgeable in the local area.
Oh, absolutely.
That's why the institutional guys don't have time to figure out every little.
No pressure about it. I mean, but it's a trade-off. You know, and it's a question of, well, do you want to potentially, you know, be able to sit back and just collect checks without any issues, problems whatsoever from your tenants? Then you invest in Class A. You know, but if you effectively, you know, be willing to work a little bit more, you can probably generate a much higher overall rate of return with the Class, you know, B and C stuff.
Class A institutional, though, wouldn't you use lower leverage on something like that? So wouldn't you actually be getting more from cash flow?
It depends. It totally depends because, you know, in some cases, even with the Class C stuff, you can leverage up really high, and you can also just pay cash for it in some cases. So, you know, it just, it totally depends on the circumstances as to what, you know, it may actually be. Because I found with a lot of the Class C stuff is that some of the best opportunities are whenever somebody is, they're just wanting to cash out because they're just tired of dealing with it, you know, after 30, 50 years or whatever, and then they're saying, okay, well, let's just sell off all of this stuff, and it's all cash flowing, you know, but it's just that their perspective is they're just wanting to kind of get out of the day-to-day maintenance aspect of it, or the management aspect of it.
So basically, pretty much...
And they're willing to, I'm sorry, okay. And they're willing to maybe owner finance it, you know, in some way, where they'll say, okay, well, you know, you put 5%, 10%, 15% down, and we'll tote the note for, you know, an extra 20 or 30 years, and so now they're only having to deal with one person as opposed to maybe 20 or 30 tenants. Sorry.
All right, so what I was asking is really pretty much based off your strategy, so you're more value add than...
Absolutely. I mean, me personally, you know, but everybody is different in that respect. I mean, you know, you know, a lot of what you're going to see in this program are the folks that tend to be more on the institutional sort of side of things. I'm not saying I'm the only one, but I, you know, tend to, this is just my own personal strategy and has been for 20 years.
So the lower the internal rate of return,
Well, the lower the internal rate of return usually implies that you've got a lower risk sort of investment. In other words, put it in another way. Think of it like this. All right. If this, in essence, is your return, and this is your risk, and we're sort of saying, to a certain extent, the Class A properties are here, Class B properties are here, Class C properties are here, you know, the risk is greater. And what I mean by the risk is greater that you're going to have difficulties in collecting the rents, difficulties in just dealing with the properties. Maybe the properties are maybe more, they're older, they're less, you know, sophisticated, they've got more maintenance issues, things like that. You know, there's higher risk there, or they're in markets that aren't inherently strong or traditionally strong economic markets, so there's that risk potentially as well. But the idea is that with that added risk, that your return is going to be dramatically higher. So the Class A property might throw off a 5% rate of return, Class B property might throw off 10% rate of return, and the Class C property might throw off a 20% rate of return.
So are you basing these classes based off like income of the tenants?
It's, in this case, the return is going to be, yes, the relationship of the income to the value of the asset. And so what we're basically saying is, to a certain extent, this return is really a cap rate, okay? And that cap rate hopefully reflects the risk, okay? Now, here's the thing. To a certain extent, risk is perception. What I perceive as risky, you may perceive as the safest thing ever, you know, and vice versa. You know, just depending on, like for example, let's say that you grew up in a particular neighborhood, all right? And you've been in that neighborhood your whole life. You understand that neighborhood. You've maybe lived outside of it at times, but you understand it. You understand the dynamics of it. You understand where the people are working, what they're doing, you know, where the income is coming from, all those sorts of things. And so you are gonna probably feel more comfortable making an investment in that neighborhood than someone that is not familiar with it at all. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And so your perception of the risk of that neighborhood is going to be a lot less than someone else. And what I'm arguing, to a certain extent, is that less known markets, also known as tertiary markets, tend to have a lot of value play. Because not everyone is breathing down on those markets to understand and evaluate. You know, when I talk about tertiary markets, I'm not talking about like West Palm or, Broward versus, Miami. I'm talking about something out in the middle of, like Gainesville would be more of a tertiary market, okay? Or Lakeland, or, something if we're using a Florida, kind of context. And, what we're talking about when, we say those tertiary markets, we're saying there's something there that potentially gives that market some value, but it's probably not a market that your institutional players are really taking a serious look at because it's not big enough for them to really take a serious look at it. Does that make sense? Okay. Because here, and I want to make this argument, that within, the Tri-County area, you've got so many sophisticated investors and players within this market that they have put under a microscope virtually every single property that exists. And combined with, you've got a lot of money that's searching for deals that are willing to spend more money relative to the income they're actually generating, that's bumping up the value of these assets to unsustainable levels. Okay? In other words, it's the whole thing of, it's kind of like, the greater fool theory of, at some point, people keep, ratcheting up the prices that, you're willing to pay $10,000 for this property. Somebody else comes along, they're willing to pay $11,000. Somebody else is willing to come along and pay $15,000, and so forth, so on. And there's maybe nothing really driving that other than, as what was it, the former Fed chair, irrational exuberance or something. That it's just basically, it's sort of ratcheting up in value. These tertiary markets, what you will find, as a general rule, most of their property values don't escalate that much. They typically tend to stay reasonably flat. The reason is you don't have a bunch of people in there getting crazy, driving up them to unsustainable artificial levels. Okay? And so, this is my own personal view. I'm not saying you have to agree with it or disagree with it. It's just the perspective is that in many instances, you may actually find more of an opportunity as a developer and as an investor in looking at some of these tertiary markets. But you're saying to yourself, well, do I really want to live in some of these tertiary markets? Maybe not. But no one says you maybe have to live there. You may have to just understand them enough to be able to develop there and invest there. If there's something, and usually one of the best ones, traditionally, I'm not saying it's going to be that way forever, but traditionally, like college towns. Because college towns are weird. Yeah. No, they're really weird. And what I mean by that is, if you take a look at census information and you take a look at income levels of college towns, you're going to see they're among the lowest. But they're not measuring things the way they should be measured. If all of a sudden, Harold is, a freshman that's being sent to, big state college in one of these college towns, Harold may not have any income whatsoever, but maybe his parents do. And I've witnessed this over and over again, especially in Texas, at Texas A&M and in UT Austin, where you would have kids that mom and dad were giving them $4,000 or $5,000 a month in spending money, plus a car, plus renting out a $2,000 a month apartment or whatever it might be. And so that kid's net expenditure would have been $5,000 a month or somewhere in that vicinity. That's equivalent to $60,000 a year of income, none of which is showing up in census information. Okay? But what is showing up are retail sales, because they're spending money on beverages, they're spending money on clothes, they're spending money on computers, they're spending money on a whole number of things within those communities, and those communities are effectively being overlooked in a lot of ways. Does that make sense? Okay. So just another sort of insight of that. Okay, moving forward. All right. Now let's talk a little bit, now that we've kind of gotten through some calculations. Let's talk some conceptual stuff, and then we'll do a little quiz and do some more conceptual stuff. Okay, so we're talking about real estate finance and kind of looking at some of the things that commercial lenders are going to require from you as an applicant for a commercial loan. Basically, their primary focus is, what is the cash flow that this property is generating, okay? And so much so that your personal financial wherewithal may be of little concern to them in some cases, depending on the circumstances. Historically, we have vacillated between what are called recourse and non-recourse loans for many, many years. Now, what do I mean by that? Non-recourse loans are ones which effectively you can go to a lender and you can say, all right, I want to buy this commercial property, this office building, and it's going to generate X number of dollars in income each year, each month, to have this sort of expenses, and the lender says, looks great, I'm willing to give you a non-recourse note. What does that mean? Well, that means that the lender is willing to give you this loan based solely on the income producing ability of that asset and is not looking to you personally to guarantee the loan. Okay? Because they're saying this property stands on its own 2 feet. Doesn't need, you know, any additional sort of backstop or additional sort of income or additional net worth to actually get the loan. Now, historically, when I say this is kind of vacillated back and forth, we have gone through periods within the past 30 years of where lenders were like so anxious to get loans, you know, to basically close loans within their banks, that they would go to you and they would just say, look, we know you've got an existing loan on your property. We know that it's recourse note, that they can come after you personally, and it's got a much, you know, higher interest rate and you know, than we're able to offer. So come sign with us. We'll make it a non-recourse note, meaning we can't come after you in the event the loan goes bad, and we're going to give you a lower interest rate. And you're saying, sign me up, okay? But it also works the other way around. Whenever the market gets a bit soft, in the sense that, you know, values are a little mushy and not quite as buoyant as maybe what they were in a growth period, then the lenders are like, no more non-recourse notes. Everything must be, basically, you've got to personally guarantee that loan with the full faith and credit of your personal sort of net worth and value. Does that make sense? Okay, now this is a big deal. A big deal. For, you know, a lot of borrowers, you will hear folks say all the time, you know, developers will talk about this and say, yeah, I was able to get a non-recourse note on that. They're very proud of that because that means, once again, they didn't have to put their net worth up to effectively back that loan. You know, developers hate having to get recourse loans because that means if that property goes belly up, they potentially could go belly up with it in the sense of other assets. Now, in a perfect economic world where everything works out in traditional theoretical economic constructs, okay, you would have a situation of where non-recourse loans would typically have higher interest rates than recourse loans, okay? Now just think about that, just make sure, I mean, it's not meant to be complicated, but in other words, if I'm the lender and I say to you, I can't come after you at all, the only satisfaction I can get if this property goes into default is to seize the property and that's it, I'm going to charge a higher interest rate for that loan than I am for one where I can come after you personally in addition to, in other words, I've got two different sources of collateral, if you will. I've got the building value, and I've got your resources as well. Does that make sense? Yes or no?
Are non-recourse typically lower LTV? Also?
It depends. You know, there are very few absolutes. That's why I tend to sort of say, okay.
Maybe yeah, kind of a little, yeah.
I mean, it's, as a general rule, yes, you would expect that non-recourse loans would have a lower loan-to-value ratio because that way that the lender doesn't worry as much. But, you know, you could also say that once again, whenever they're in, you know, growth times, you know, there's a very good chance that in order for that lender to be competitive, they may have to raise up that loan-to-value ratio relative to their competition. And here's the thing, that you actually bring up an extremely good point. Think of lenders as retailers, okay? It's what they are. I mean, yeah, you can make some arguments, maybe they are, maybe they aren't, but they're really retailers. They're retailers. You know, just like Walmart and, you know, any other sort of, you know, CVS or Walgreens or whatever, they're a retailer. And what do I mean by that? Well, no two lenders are identical in terms of the kind of deal that they're going to offer you. They're going to be always some variations of what they're potentially going to offer you. One lender may specialize in only doing apartment loans. Another lender may specialize in only doing office building loans, or only doing industrial loans, or only doing hotel loans, or only doing mixed use, or only, you know. Now, and when I say lenders, I'm using this in a broader context than just simply like Wells Fargo or Bank One or, you know, whatever. I'm talking about lenders that could be institutional players, could be, you know, hedge funds, could be real estate investment trust, could be, you know, a wide variety of sources of capital for you to potentially borrow money from, because you can get money from a mortgage REIT indirectly. Okay, so the thing to think about when I get back to this whole lenders or retailers is this whole business that what they're initially going to try to draw you into the front door with is a low stated interest rate, okay? Because that's the one thing that they think that everybody understands. You know, in other words, I mean, how many times have you been pulled into a credit card because they say zero interest for X number of months, or you've been pulled into a furniture store, zero interest for 24 months, or, you know, so forth. It's a tool to bring you into the door. Well, the same sort of thing is true with lenders with regard to making loans on real estate, that this lender, once again, may say, we've got a 6% interest rate with, but this one over here, is I think I maybe can give the example earlier, maybe a 6.25, but this one is saying, well, but for that 6%, we're gonna charge you upfront loan origination fees. So when you make this loan, you're going to have to pay a certain percentage of the value of that loan to us in upfront fees. Well, you may also be hit with a situation of, if you choose to pay off this loan early, we're going to charge you a prepayment penalty for paying off the loan early. They may also have some sort of an administrative fee that they charge you on a monthly or annual basis that's like a servicing fee. Okay, they literally are charging you money to take your monthly payment. Okay, I mean, there's all sorts of hidden fees, if you will, that can be charged to the lender. Well, part of what we're going to be doing is looking at how do you go about taking all of those hidden fees and then figuring out, well, what is your true effective cost of borrowing? You know, it's not going to be 6.25, it's probably going to be, or not going to be just 6, it's going to be something dramatically higher than that. Does that make sense? Okay, and so that's what I'm sort of saying, that one lender may not have any loan origination fees. Another lender has some that are just astronomical. One lender may not have any administrative fees. Another one may not have any loan prepayment penalty fees. But then another lender may have all three of those. Okay? Then you've got other issues. Another issue is going to be reserve requirements. Some lenders are going to say, you need to set aside, in addition to your mortgage payment to us, you need to set aside an extra dollar amount that we put on cash reserves to take into account any sort of unforeseen circumstance that could happen to the property while you have the loan with us. And what I mean by unforeseen circumstance, that possibly you've got to replace the roof sooner than you expected, or replace an air conditioner sooner than you expected. It's going to be a capital expenditure, and the lender doesn't want you basically crawling back to them and saying, hey, I need some more money to put on a new roof, I need some more money to put a, you know, a new air conditioner in. They want you to have that money already on reserve at their bank. Well, once again, that dollar amount or percentage or whatever it is going to vary from one lender to the next. But that makes a difference as to, you know, effectively the true cost of borrowing that money. Because to a certain extent, it's almost like putting up additional equity. Okay, in terms of, you know, additional down payment, if you will. Okay. Now, another thing is documentation. And what I mean by that is not just the upfront documentation that may be required by a lender, but the ongoing documentation that may be required by a lender. This is extremely important. That you may have a lender, I mean, traditionally, let's look back historically. Historically, lenders, you know, they would make you the loan. As long as you made your monthly payments to them for the duration of the loan, they left you alone. They didn't ever come knocking on your door saying, hey, give me some more information about how your property's doing. They just collected their mortgage payment and were thrilled about that. Now, what is becoming much more commonplace is for lenders saying up front, and it's evolving as we sort of are here, and part of the reason it's evolving is because of the ease of maybe getting this information and processing this information. But lenders are saying now, if we make you this loan, this commercial loan, we want you to provide us, in addition to your monthly mortgage payment, we want you to provide us with a monthly operating statement on the property. Why would they want that? They want to see how it's doing. You know, because they want to use that information as potentially an early warning system as to the property not generating income. That so on a month-to-month basis, because think about this logically here for a second. All right, so you've got a tenant, or you've got a you're the lender. You've made this loan to this person that's purchased this building, and you know months are going by. They're making their normal monthly payments. Everything is great. You think everything is wonderful from the perspective of the lender. No issues, no problems. And then just all of a sudden, maybe they start making late payments. And you're thinking, okay, well, they hit maybe a little hiccup, whatever, no big deal. You know, and then all of a sudden those late payments turn into no payments. And then you're like, all of a sudden, what the heck happened as a lender? Well, then you've got to, you know, start, you know, going and investigating, well, you know, what's going on. And then by that point, in many cases, it's too late. Because that person has probably used all the money, that the free and clear cash flow that they had to make those final few payments. And then, you know, we're hoping things were going to somehow get better, and they didn't. And now you're faced with a situation where you're probably going to have to foreclose on the property and shut it down and take it over. Whereas, if you were collecting those monthly operating statements, and those were actual reflections of how the property is doing, and you were to see a pattern, oh, what's going on here? We lost a tenant. Oh, we lost another tenant. Oh, lost another tenant. You know, or those tenants aren't paying their leases, then you as the lender might be able to intervene much sooner and say, you're not living up to the terms and conditions of the property in terms of keeping it occupied at a certain level or meeting a certain requirement with regard to income. And so therefore, now we're going to take control Not possession, I mean, not possession in the traditional sense. We're gonna take control of your property and start managing your property because we don't want to end up in foreclosure.
So is that receivership?
Not quite to that point, but close. I mean, it's basically a situation of where you are now in technical default. Not actual default, technical default. And so in sort of actual versus technical default. Let me explain this. Actual default is where you stop making payments, okay? In other words, you're not making your monthly mortgage payment. A technical default is where you have failed to meet an ongoing condition of your loan documents, okay? And that's where it's a situation of where you have lost maybe a couple of your key tenants, and you were required by your loan documents to maintain, let's say, an 85% occupancy ratio in the property. And if you fall below that 85%, you are to notify the lender immediately, you know, upon that happening. And what may also be a requirement is that the lender may say, any new tenants that go into the property, we have to approve them. You're saying, whoa, wait a second. Why would the lender need to approve? Well, think about it. From the lender's perspective, where is the money coming from to pay the mortgage? From the tenants. So really, the quality of the tenants, to a certain extent, is equally important, if not more important, to the economic viability of the project than the financial wherewithal of the property owner. You follow what I'm saying? Because you may have lenders starting to say, okay, we are going to require that every new tenant must be approved by us, and they may have some standards that, you know, they must meet a certain, you know, rating from S&P or Dun & Bradstreet or, you know, credit score if it's an individual or whatever it is to move into this property. But the whole idea behind that is they want, obviously, what are considered to be credit tenants. Okay, people that are going to pay the rent. And therefore, translating into, they're going to get their mortgage payment. Okay, make sense? Okay, any questions on that?
How far can they kind of, you know, manipulate them?
It depends, because where a lot of this emerged within the past 10, 15 or so years has been, a lot of it has come from the commercial mortgage-backed securities industry. And commercial mortgage-backed securities, you know, really came, got super popular around 99, 2000, somewhere around in there. They've kind of ebbed and flowed a little bit, but basically what commercial mortgage-backed securities are, we'll get into a more detailed explanation later, but very simply put, they are a source of capital that can be used by lending institutions, that lending institutions can tap into, that provide a relatively cheap source of capital for real estate, but they have a lot of strings attached. And so what happens is, as an individual, go and get a mortgage loan from ABC Bank, okay? You know, you at ABC Bank are like, all right, we're gonna do this, you know, $5 million, you know, loan. And then what you do as ABC Bank is you've made a whole bunch of those $5 million loans to a bunch of other people. And at some point, you have exhausted all of your internal funds, and so you're like, I'm gonna sell off those loans to someone else. Well, that someone else is a commercial mortgage-backed security in the sense that a special purpose entity of this mortgage-backed security is going to accumulate all of your loans and package them together, possibly with even some other folks, and that is then going to effectively throw off a rate of return to some investors that are buying into that commercial mortgage-backed security. But it's giving you now free and clear cash to be able to re-lend to other people, okay? But now that mortgage-backed security, typically they have a lot of restrictions, and the thing is, whenever I made that loan with you, one of the things that I did was I signed a release saying, yeah, you can sell my loan off into the secondary mortgage market into this commercial mortgage-backed security. And then they have all these wonderful restrictions of saying, now, yeah, you got to provide me with monthly operating statements, you must maintain a certain level of occupancy, you must get our approval in the event that you change tenants, a whole number of things come into play. Now, part of the reason why that I chose to go down that path of signing that was in the promise I'm gonna get a lower interest rate. Well, that lower interest rate is great, assuming I'm willing to put up with all of those other things that now I'm going to be subject to in terms of all of these additional disclosures, all these other pieces of paper that are going to flow into this. And so, a lot of people aren't willing to make that trade-off. And, and so they may just simply say, well, I'll take the higher interest rate loan so I don't have to deal with all that stuff. But then other people are saying, well, I'll take the lower interest rate loan and I'm willing to put up with that stuff because it'll save me, a 0.5% or 1% on the interest rate. Make sense? Yep.
How easy is it to go into technical default if, for instance, it's...
It totally depends on the actual specifications of the loan document.
Let's say that you need like a 1.3
debt coverage ratio, okay.
And you happen to be negative 1 year. Because of tax purposes, depreciation.
It depends on how aggressive that lender wants to be. It's really what it boils down to. I mean, it's at the lender's discretion, and if you don't meet that standard, and they know that you haven't met that standard, it's at their discretion as to how aggressive they want to be. Now, when I say it's at their discretion, in some cases, it's really not at their discretion. If they're aware of it, they must then enforce the conditions because technically they are the folks that are servicing these loans, because you, without getting into all the details now, but you've got primary servicers, master servicers, and special servicers on these commercial mortgage-backed securities, and what happens is whenever you go into technical default, it gets moved into what's called special servicing, which means kind of almost all bets are off. It's kind of like anything can happen at that point because the special servicer has a lot of control as to how far they want to push things and what sort of things they can do on behalf of the underlying bondholders of the CMBS. Rosie, do you have a question or a comment there?
Could you appeal?
I'm sorry?
Could you appeal?
Not so much. It's kind of like you signed it. You've agreed to it. And the thing is, these folks are hardcore. I mean, when I say it's kind of like it's painting. You owe me the money, pay me. And, they're not going to break in your legs, but it's pretty close in the sense of they're, definitely going to take, action to take away the property or the property rights or the management of the property. And you really have very little control at that point because you have not met some precondition of the arrangement that was made up front.
I was going to say, I wonder how often it happens, because of interest rates moving up and bank wanting to get their money back, or somebody coming in a back door to buying a note and enforcing somebody.
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, one of the consulting opportunities I had for a number of years was working with Oryx Capital Markets in Dallas, which they are a servicer of commercial loans. They were doing, at the time, they were doing about $1 billion worth of payments every single month, receiving in and remitting those to the bondholders. And, I sat in on a number of the special servicing meetings, and some of the things that, would go on, you'd just be like, wow, in terms of having to, I guess the amount of effort that would go into collecting those payments. And then also charging penalties and the fees that would go along with, those penalties. Like one of the most common things that would come up would be folks wanting to sell the property and prepay the note. Okay? Well, most of these commercial mortgage-backed securities, the way that they were set up, were typically like 5-year balloon notes. Or 7 years, you know, it sort of depended, but many of them were 5 years. Okay? So, you know, I go get the loan from you, you sell it off to the commercial mortgage-backed security, 5-year balloon note. Let's say 3 years into that note, somebody comes along, offers me a boatload of money relative to what I have in the property. I'm wanting to sell and sell now. So I go to you and you go to him and say, nope, you can't, you know, you can't sell. Effectively, there's a prepayment, it's a lockout, what's called a lockout provision. And what that means is you are locked out from prepaying the mortgage. Well, then, you know, you're just like, oh, I refuse to accept that I am locked out from prepaying the mortgage. And then they say, well, there's only one option. You know, you're going to have to pay defeasance. You're like, defeasance? What's defeasance? Well, it's basically, it's a souped up version of prepayment penalty. And what it basically boils down to is you're going to have to prepay all of the interest up front that all the bondholders would receive for the remainder of the term of the loan, in addition to a prepayment penalty. And so in many cases, this would amount to like 15 to 30% of the outstanding mortgage balance that you would have to pay in fees and charges to pay off that loan early. Well, so then you've got to be determining, is it really worth me selling this property now and having to incur all of those penalties? Or should I wait for another year and a half and hope the market doesn't turn on me and get stuck with this property? You know, and so that's one issue. Another issue is that, okay, let's say that I go through the full 5 years, okay? And at the end of the 5 years, I'm gonna do one of a couple of different things. I'm either gonna refinance the property, I'm gonna sell the property, okay? Well, to refinance the property, what if the market's gone down in that 5-year period? I'm screwed. Because now all of a sudden, in order to refinance that property, I'm gonna have to potentially put in more equity into the deal in order to get it refinanced. Well, what if I can't come up with an additional equity? Okay, then I'm in a situation, now I'm gonna be in default of not being able to pay off the mortgage balance, so they're potentially gonna take possession of the property. Okay, or if I try to sell the property, well, yet we got another problem, because if I'm not able to sell it for the full mortgage balance, because see, that's the other thing. Many of the commercial mortgage-backed securities loans were highly leveraged. In many instances, they would allow you to borrow maybe up to 85, 90% of the value of the asset. Well, if the value of the asset's gone down by 20%, and you haven't paid off into that much of your mortgage loan over that 5-year period, because most of that mortgage is going to be interest over that first 5 years, you really haven't paid down much of it, so therefore you're going to be stuck in a situation of where you're basically not able to sell the property either, because you're going to have a loss. So there's some real issues and problems, you know, surrounding that. You have to be very, very careful about that. Now, anytime the market's increasing, you know, everything's great. You know, you can refinance without a problem. You know, you can obviously sell without a problem, but you know, anytime that you have that fluctuation in the market, and that's you know, it can become catastrophic very quickly.
With scenario one, with the, like you were saying, the prepayment penalties, how are they with assignability or being able to like subject to, like they were saying, like it's a prepayment penalty, but if this buyer wants to come in, you know, take over the mortgage.
Yeah. It's a real challenge. I mean, it's a situation they refuse to transfer title because they said that this deal was with you. And to a certain extent, they're doing it on purpose because there are fees involved. Okay, and that's the thing that you know. This is another very valuable lesson. Extremely valuable lesson. In the residential mortgage market, there are tons of consumer protection things that are in existence to protect anybody and everybody, whenever you go get a mortgage loan for your personal residence, the government has so many consumer protection devices put in there to keep you from potentially being taken advantage of by unscrupulous lenders. On the commercial side, pretty much not a thing. It's buyer beware. Because the thought process is, you're a smart guy, you're in business, you should be able to make a deal on your own without the government basically standing and having to protect you from making a bad deal. If you make a bad deal, too bad for you, too sad, you know, and move on. And so, to a large extent, the commercial loan business is not as regulated whenever it comes to consumer protection kinds of things. It is regulated, you know, in other ways, but not so much in that way. It is regulated whenever it comes to, like, the use of appraisals and ensuring that you know, appraisals are being done properly and that they're not being inflated and that you know, effectively reasonable credit checks are being done and that sort of thing. But as far as like all of the weird, crazy fees and charges and things like that, not so much. Okay. Now, another thing, actually, you can spur another thought as it relates to this, and we talked a little bit about this in the investments course, that one of the emerging markets, I think, for real estate financing is crowdfunding. And I think that, you know, already, you know, it's become a multi-billion dollar market within the past, you know, several years of, you know, projects being financed in a very different way than historically they had been financed. And I think, you know, there is a tremendous opportunity for us to kind of begin to explore, you know, the possibilities of crowdfunding as an alternative to traditional, you know, lenders. You know, it has pros and cons, just like, you know, everything does, but the extent to which that, you know, that becomes kind of an emerging source of capital for people looking to do developments or make investments, especially, you know, as it relates to trying to invest in maybe traditionally underserved neighborhoods and things where you can get the local residents to sort of rally together and put up the funds to potentially build a new grocery store or whatever it might be within that area to better serve their needs in the community that wouldn't be done otherwise, you know, or provide lower income housing in a neighborhood that potentially, once again, would not exist without some level of support in that direction. So yeah, that's another thing to potentially sort of throw in there, okay? Thoughts, questions, observations, okay? All right. Another thing, as we're sort of talking about loans, collateralization. You ever heard of that term before? Okay. So, okay, Dustin has. Okay, Dustin, what is it?
Cross collateralization. Let's say you own property A, you want to buy property B, and as collateral for buying property B, you tell the bank, you know, if I fail in B, you get the equity in A.
Yes. So the whole idea here is that you may have similar or different. I mean, the one example that I remember, because it was my first time to ever be exposed to it, was some guy that owned a bunch of Burger Kings. And he owned like 35 Burger Kings, and these were all basically cross-collateralized with each other. So that whenever he got the financing for all 35 Burger Kings, that in essence, if one defaulted, then the lender could basically seek out the cash flow from another one, okay? Well, there are pros and cons to that, you know, obviously, that, you know, you could have a situation of where your whole empire could fall if everything is cross-collateralized. It's like a domino effect that, you know, you may have a handful of really, really bad ones that basically cause the really good ones to totally collapse. But yet, why would you do it? Well, it might offer you a cheaper source of financing because the lender is saying, I've got more collateral to choose from in the event that something goes bad, okay? But as I said, the flip side is, well, yeah, if something does go bad, you potentially could lose a lot more you know, as well as the borrower. Okay, make sense? Okay. Now, what about, one of the things I mentioned earlier was this whole idea of lenders looking at the respective tenants within a property, the commercial tenants, and sort of basing the loan that you receive on the property strictly off of those tenants, as opposed to being based upon your creditworthiness as a borrower. Well, could you see a situation, kind of carrying this to the logical extreme, that let's say that we've got, I'm just going to drop an example here, try to keep things relatively simple. So let's say that we've got a little shopping center, okay? This is an overly simplified example to try to illustrate the concept. We've got four tenants in this shopping center, and each space is, you know, about the same, I don't know, it's 5,000 square feet, okay, of space in each one of these, okay? And so we go to the lender, and we say, okay, we want to get a loan on this little shopping center. And so, and specifically, we want to get a non-recourse loan on the shopping center. And so the lender says, well, okay, great. I'll give you a loan on the shopping center, but it's going to be completely dependent upon the tenants that you have within that center. Okay? So, theoretically, just kind of imagine this with me for a moment, that we've, just to be consistent with what I've got here, that we said the Class A tenant, or the tenant A, just happens to be a Class A tenant with a very high credit rating, and so maybe they're willing to give you a 3% loan on that tenant, but then they evaluate the credit of tenant B and maybe 5% interest rate on that one, and then on C, a lot worse, maybe 10% interest rate on that one. And then on the D one, it's pretty much just an absolute dog, so maybe a 20% interest rate, okay? So now, you know, you can sort of say, okay, well, we could have a blended rate, and it's kind of like averaging those and just sort of say, well, what's the blended rate for the property? You know, and very simply to say, to keep it, you know, without getting overly complicated here, 3 plus 5 plus 10 plus 20 is 38 divided by 4. So it gives us a blended rate of 9.5% for the property overall. So the lender says to you, all right, I'm gonna give you a loan on the property, 9.5% is gonna be the interest rate. And you're saying, wow, that seems really high. And the lender says, well, it's because, you know, you've got a couple of kind of lousy tenants in terms of the quality of their, you know, sort of credit scores, or once again, you know, whatever ratings that we're using. And so, well, if you want to improve that interest rate, you get better tenants. You follow my logic here? And so you spend some time scouting around, you find some better tenants, and maybe you're able to obviously lower these rates closer to what those are, dramatically lowers your overall cost of borrowing, giving you potentially a higher cash flow, potentially from the property. Okay, so what I'm trying to do is to get you to think about this, okay, you know, in terms of the reality of this becoming reality. I mean, and in terms of lenders kind of going this far and saying, we're going to look at your property tenant by tenant, and we're going to assign a risk profile tenant by tenant. And as a result, you're going to have some sort of a blended thing. And you're saying, well, wait a second. Another way of looking at this is, it's almost like you're condominiumizing the loan. I mean, to a certain extent, that's what you're doing. Is you're pretty much saying, all right, you know, you've got four different tenants that are almost coming to you, you know, they could be coming to you individually. And you're saying, well, this one, I'm willing to give you a 3% loan because you've obviously got a great credit history. But this one over here, you've had, you know, all kinds of credit issues and non-payments and foreclosures and judgments and, you know, whatever other, you know, nasty financial messes that you've created for yourself, and, you know, that's the best that you're going to get. So, I mean, what do you think about this as a concept? I mean, do you think that's realistic? Do you think it's we're moving in that direction? Do you think there's no chance? What are your thoughts in terms of the evolution of lending?
You're looking directly to the source, right?
Yeah.
It's also like kind of a pain to have to be reassessing every time a tenant moves in or out. Or.
But it's exactly what the lender in some cases is doing. They're saying, we've got to get approval before you move, excuse me, before you move a new tenant in there. And to a certain extent, you could sort of take this a couple steps further and say, all right, well, yeah, you're going to move a new tenant in? Is that a bad credit rating? Because think about it like this. Let's say that initially you filled your building up only with Class A tenants. You got your loan at 3%. But then, a couple of years later, those Class A tenants moved out for reasons unknown, whatever you know those were. And the best tenants that you could possibly get 2 or 3 years later, to use the extreme, were the Class D tenants. You think your lenders would be very happy about that? Not at all. So what's the recourse that the lender has? You see what I'm saying? You know, and so,
we're almost like a partner in the building at some point.
That's my point, is that the lenders, to a certain extent, are almost becoming not silent partners, but more engaged, you know, partners, you know, within the process than they've ever really been before. And part of the reason they're able to, I mean, historically, they would have never done this. And the reason they wouldn't, because the information technology support systems weren't there to allow stuff like this to happen. But now, so much of this can be done with a few keystrokes to be able to pull up. What is the credit rating of this versus this versus this versus this? And the lender, you know, being able to kind of say, let's use that information. Why ignore it?
So is it more like a balance type of thing where, you know, like a lot of commercial properties, they're going to recourse. So that means it's not really based off of your income. So
that's what I'm saying.
Yeah, they would be more intimate in it because it's based off of that. But in the same time, if you do go, you know, recourse, have a recourse loan, are they going to be that intimate until?
Probably not, because there they've got that extra source of collateral to look after.
Right.
You know, I mean, in other words, that they have available to them. Because you know what they're saying with, you know, potentially if this was, you know, set up as a non-recourse loan, that we've got to be looking as the lender to those individual tenants to satisfy, you know, whatever, you know, financial obligations are necessary for this property to be able to survive. And so all I'm trying to do is to get you to sort of think about how the evolution of basically lending, you know, where we are now versus where we were versus where potentially we will be going. And I tend to think, you know, I've seen some of this already, you know, but it's still kind of, you know, it's kind of like in that research and development phase, you know, with some of the lenders beginning to kind of toy around with this sort of as a concept, you know, to be able to roll it out more large scale, you know, requires a bit more effort. Because here, I mean, many of you either have taken or are taking like the Argus class, yes? Okay, now, in that Argus class, one of the things that you should have been required to do is you have to put together like a rent roll. Okay, those of you that have taken it, and those of you that haven't, it's okay because I'm not going to make it overly complicated. You're going to put together like a rent roll that says you got tenant A, tenant B, tenant C, tenant D, and so forth. Here's their lease term, here's their lease amount, here's what it's based on, yada, yada, yada. Now, one field that's not inherently present within that, to my recollection, at least in the last time I used Argus, was to basically say, well, what was like the credit rate or the credit score for each of those tenants? But that would be something that would be very easily addable, if you will, to that, that could factor into the analysis. You follow what I'm saying? And so, once again, all I'm trying to do is to once again stimulate you to sort of think about this in the terms, because the lender is concerned about pretty much one thing, getting paid. And at the same time, being competitive with other lenders within the marketplace for your business. And so if this lender can come up with a scheme that basically says, you give me all Class A tenants, I'm going to give you a 3% interest rate. Whereas the normal interest rate in the market might be 4 or 5%. You follow? But on the flip side, you know, they're also going to potentially charge you a heck of a lot more in the event, and you know, they may even be willing to say, look, we'll make this loan, but we're going to charge you a 20% interest rate to do so. Now, it might not be, once again, your traditional Wells Fargo sort of bank doing this. It may be some other, you know, kind of financial institution, but it's not necessarily going to be your traditional commercial bank. Okay. Other thoughts on this? Okay. So, okay, we've got this whole little model here of kind of thinking about it and you know the terms of kind of parsing out the individual sort of risk profile of these folks. I mean, can you think of anything else that a lender might do to potentially market to you as a commercial loan seeker that they could somehow mitigate their risk but offer you some other sort of interesting little deal? Do you follow what I'm asking? In other words, you know, much like this, is there some other marketing tool that a lender could use to basically make themselves look that much more attractive to a commercial borrower? Some other sort of scheme, some other sort of, I mean, think about it, what I'm trying to get you to do is to think about it from a marketing perspective, but yet, along with that marketing perspective, something that's gonna maybe potentially reduce their risk, therefore, that's a reason why they're able to lower that interest rate. You follow what I'm saying? If the underlying goal is to lower the overall stated interest rate in exchange for some other sort of gimmick, what might that be, Jordan?
Well, I think if, you know, potentially they have, how they look at the property more than the borrower, maybe what they could do is increase the weighting on the strength of the borrower and either leave the same or decrease the weighting of the property.
Okay.
To some, you know, percentage, and maybe be able to be more competitive and issue a better interest rate going off of that, and kind of leaving the traditional emphasis on the property.
Okay.
Commercial properties.
Okay. Anybody else?
Sure. How about some sort of insurance product on the lease payment that they're supposed to be getting from the tenants?
In terms of basically sort of.
Yeah, if the tenants don't pay, the insurance keeps it.
Gotcha. Sort of like, yeah, mortgage insurance, like for the residential side, but it's another variation of that. Okay, anything else?
Increase the term of the loan.
Yeah. This is one of the things that, unfortunately, tends to happen whenever the market starts to get, you know, a bit overheated, is that lenders start looking for any possible way to help them to make loans. And you know, part of the problem is that in a buoyant market, okay, values have done what? They have gone up, okay? And what that's gonna mean, even you know, if interest rates have remained constant, your payments are gonna go up as well. So the lender only has so many different tools at their disposal to keep that payment at a reasonable, respectable level. And so one of the things that they, in a lot of cases, turn to are, well, what about if we increase the term from 20 years to 30 years? What if we increase the term from 30 years to 40 years? What if we increase the term from 40 to 50 years? Or, and or, make it an interest-only loan. One of the ways, well, one of the early warning signs of the crash, you know, in 2006-ish, 7-ish, was you were seeing just that. You were seeing all of these loans that were being made, in many instances, the terms were increasing. We had never, before then, had gone beyond like a 30-year mortgage. All of a sudden, they were entering into the territory of, some cases, 35, 40, you know, 50 years. And then the other thing was saying, oh, we're gonna do interest-only mortgages. Well, what does that mean? Well, interest-only mortgage means you don't pay down any of the principal balance, okay? But in other words, you borrow $100,000 and you charge a 5% interest on that, so $5,000 a year, let's say, interest only, and there is no principal reduction. So 5 years later, you still owe $100,000. Does everybody follow that?
Yeah.
Well, it's interesting because if you take a look historically at kind of the mortgages that were on offer, the interest-only mortgage was pretty much the first one. Matter of fact, if you go back to the 1800s here in this country, and you take a look at the mortgages that were being offered, virtually every single one of them was an interest-only mortgage. This is why, for those of you that have ever watched Westerns, you know, not as popular today as they used to be, but if you've ever watched some of the old school Westerns, you know, the traditional Western was, you know, you have the family farmer or the rancher or whatever goes and buys a farm or a ranch, goes to the local bank in the town, gets a loan, you know, a mortgage on the property, and, you know, goes out, improves the property, puts up a barn, puts up a house, you know, fences, starts getting livestock and all this. And then you always, it always, always, always ends up that they end up in default and are getting foreclosed on by the bank. I mean, is that not the plot for a lot of the Westerns, okay? Well, there's a reason for that. No, and all joking and everything serious, is because of the way the mortgages were structured. Because the way the mortgages were structured, they were, in many cases, short-term interest-only loans. So you are the farmer rancher, you come to me as the lender, and I give you $100,000 to go out, buy your land, build your, you know, farm and ranch, get all your livestock, all that sort of stuff. And the deal that I make with you is, okay, 3 years from now, 5 years from now, whatever the time frame that we had set, usually a roughly short time horizon, by that point, you had gotten all of your stuff done, you know, in terms of built the house, built the, you know, built everything up. And, but you borrow that $100,000 from me, and you've been making these interest-only payments, so that $100,000, even at 10% a year, interest-only, you were making $10,000 of interest payments to me for 5 years, but at the end of 5 years, you still owe me $100,000. Well, here's the problem. Unless you're stuffing $20,000 a year extra into your mattress, you're not going to have that $100,000 5 years from now. You follow me? Okay. So what are you going to be forced to do at the end of that 5 years? You're either going to have to sell the property, and the liquidity back then isn't what it is now in terms of being able to sell, you know, your family farm or ranch. Okay. Because only a handful of people have the money to be able to do so. Okay. So chances are what would happen is you don't have the $100,000. Too bad, so sad. Lender forecloses, takes your property back from you, and then what does he do? He leases it back to you and makes a ton of money just off of the lease, but he ends up owning the property. Okay? Does that make sense? Yes or no? Okay? Well, okay. So we get through that period of time, pretty much, once again, a good portion of the 1800s, you know, the whole Western expansion, the railroads, and all that. You know, deal with pretty much a lot of these kind of interest-only sort of loans. And it wasn't until the early 1900s, about 1920-ish, that we ended up with what we are familiar with, which is the fixed rate mortgage, okay? And meaning, and specifically, one of the mortgages that was introduced was called the constant amortization mortgage. And what would happen here, very simply, is we had a $100,000 mortgage, and from a simple calculation perspective, we would say, all right, we're going to get this loan for 10 years, So that means that over that 10 years, we've got to pay $10,000 in principal payments each year on that loan, in addition to whatever the interest payments were. But the point was that each year, the balance of the loan would drop by 10 grand. And so that at the end of 10 years, it was zero. Does that make sense? Now, you're saying, well, that's not how the normal mortgages work today. No, it's not. The reason why this was done, and the reason why the previous type, the interest only, was done, think about the calculations. Now, what I mean, and Jordan, I think you understand, I mean, people were doing this by hand, okay? They didn't have a calculator. They didn't have Excel. So the kind of calculations that would be necessary to do the kind of mortgages that we have today would not have really been possible back then. And so technology, this is the theme I'm trying to sort of throw out here. Technology drives ultimately the kind of loans that are able to be made at any given time in our history. So, you know, we start out with these very simple interest-only loans, we migrate to the constant amortization loan, then later, whenever we have the computing power to be able to do so, then we start doing what we're familiar with, which is the constant payment mortgage or constant or, as we also call it, a fixed payment mortgage. Because see, the thing with the constant amortization mortgage is, if you actually, and we'll go through an example of this, not tonight, but another time, is that your actual monthly payment changes over time. It starts out really high, and then over time, the actual total payment of principal and interest declines significantly as that mortgage balance is declining. Well, the same thing is happening here, except that you're billing it all in, so the payment, the actual dollar amount you're writing each month or each year is fixed. So it's the same dollar amount. It's not going to just be declining over time. It's going to be fixed as a dollar amount. Well, you think that the next iteration, as technology evolved, what happened in the 1970s? As our computing power increased, adjustable rate mortgages. Okay? Why would we need more computing power to do adjustable rate mortgages? Because potentially, every month, every year, every 6 months, whatever the time period would be for the adjustment, you're gonna have to recalculate everything. I mean, the first mortgage that I had was, I think, in 1991 for a house that I had bought, and back then interest rates were much higher, but the adjustable rate mortgage I had started out at about 8% and went, and over the time that I held the property, went as high as like 9.5%. Okay? And but from 1 month to the next, you didn't know what your mortgage payment was going to be. Okay? Why would the lender do that? Well, the lender does it because interest rates do vary over time, and lenders want to do what? Reduce their risk. And so if I got a fixed rate mortgage at the time that I got the property, I may have had to pay 9.5%. But instead, I was able to maybe get an 8% variable rate. You follow? Because the lender would want to lock in that rate for a long period of time. But the technology sort of drove that to a certain extent, of the lenders being able to do an adjustable rate mortgage. And so what I'm saying now is, now that we're moving in to this ridiculous amount of information that is at our disposal, we're able to collect, the lender is able to collect and require so much information from you as the borrower and from the individual tenants that are occupying the properties, that they're able to start making the loans based on those individual cash flows and risk profiles of those individual tenants. So it's technology that's really driving a lot of this, and we have to begin to think, well, what are the next steps in this evolutionary process? You know,